Just. This. Yes. First of all, yes. Thanks, all of you, for coming, and thanks a lot. Already at the beginning to Toru, I think you guys are doing amazing work here. And so I was asked to talk a little bit about SoulShare, or what we are doing. So some of you might now know, or some of you don't know. So we are an energy company. So we work in the area of what many people call energy access. So the problem we are trying to solve is that many people around the world do not have access to energy or to electricity especially. And I would like to start maybe with a small history lesson. So as I said, we are working in energy, and in the year 1879, one of the greatest inventors in the human history, Thomas Edison, invented the light bulb. And also that was the start of the energy grids, or electricity grids as we know them today. And at this time, there were around 1.3 billion people living on this planet, and none of them had access to electricity. And when Thomas Edison invented the light bulb, he said this sentence: "We are going to make energy so cheap that only the rich people will burn candles." And many, many years later, in 2013, my partner and colleague and the initial founder of SoulShare, Sebastian Koh, he was thinking about the idea, okay, how could we work on this problem? Because in 2013, what was actually reality? Worldwide, there were still 1.3 billion people without access to electricity. Exactly the same number which we had when Thomas Edison invented the light bulb. And the worst thing about it is, even though Thomas Edison said energy will be so cheap, only the rich people will burn the candles, it was still the poor people who are burning the candles. And that's actually a big problem. And it usually shows also one of these dilemmas which poor people are facing. If you compare, for example, what you pay here in Dhaka for your energy, we are talking about maybe like, I don't know what's the tariff right now, I think it was around 7 taka per kilowatt hour, or around $10. If you go to the rural areas, even still in Bangladesh today, people are easily paying $10 per kilowatt hour. If you, for example, want to have light, or you pay around $4 if you do things like mobile phone charging. So the problem hasn't gone away. But then I would also like to come directly to the point, why did we actually decide to work in Bangladesh? Because this energy access problem is very big all around the world, but when we looked into it, like how are people actually solving this? There was no way to get around Bangladesh. And it's also what happened here is, or what I would like to talk about, is the solar home system program, which started in Bangladesh. Many, many years ago, I mean, the first initiatives in this direction were already at the end of the, around 1998, but it got much bigger than later. So what we basically saw here is that many people, and I think that's also one thing which I really would like to point out, which fascinates me about this country, is already in the early 2000s, people were saying, like, we don't want to wait for the electricity to come to us, we're gonna bring it to us ourselves. And these were these solar systems that people started buying. And the result of this is today, official numbers say 5 million households are using these are even more. Just to give you a little bit an idea of what this actually means. This means, I don't know how often you guys here yourself still go to the villages, 25% of the rural households are using solar energy as their primary source of electricity. And all these houses, they made their own private investment, they took their own initiative and said, like, I'm not going to wait, I'm just going to access it somehow. And what they get out of it is basic light services, mobile phone charging, but there it often already stops. But you're a fast developing country. And also these people would like to have more. And often is the question then, what is the next step? What comes after these small solar systems? And we were also thinking like, what actually comes after it? That's right. People made investment and so on. So the usual answer to this is, or what every government usually says, like, we're going to bring the national grid to you, like the big grid. But we thought that's a waste of resources, because all these houses already made an investment into their own solar system, and if you just bring them now a different technology on top of it, which is not really integrated, this is a huge waste of resources. So what we at Solcher basically do, we said there's this huge potential of solar systems, and let's bring this to the next level. So how we often call it is bottom-up electrification, which basically means nothing else than enabling people to start maybe with a standalone system, but to build their own grid. And I don't know if there's any country which is better for this than Bangladesh, because you have the systems here. And the second thing is, somehow people here have this tendency to just do it themselves, not waiting, I just do it. So that's mainly why we started here. Now I want to come to something, and that's a little bit in the transition into how we started working with Toru. So we had always this principle when we in Solcher, we have something as an indicator, how we, one of our core values is something what we call the 5 D's. The 5 D's are decentralization, decarbonization, digitalization, democratization, and disrupt. So let me go into this a little bit. What do I actually mean with this? The first part is decentralization. Energy systems on the whole planet and everywhere are totally changing. Since we have solar energy available, the way how you can provide electricity to people has totally changed. And the number one principle behind it is, you don't need to put up giant power plants anymore. You don't need to go into like huge power systems. Nowadays you can create energy where it's consumed. So the whole energy markets get totally decentralized. Instead of supplying a village from a power plant which is maybe 100 kilometers away, you can just set a small system up there and supply the village. So that's this decentralization where we are looking a lot into, and which is what I think the future of energy markets. Of course, we need to talk about decarbonization, especially in a country like Bangladesh. I don't need to tell you how vulnerable the country is towards climate change. I can just give you the comparison. Where I live in Germany, I live around 500 meters above sea level. Dhaka is at 4 meters above sea level. So everyone can imagine what happens if the sea level rises. I also often hear the stories like, yeah, but we are not responsible for climate change. That's right. But you're the most vulnerable. And if you don't show any kind of examples in Bangladesh, how you can supply energy in a different way, decarbonized, nobody will listen. So it's up to you to be the example, and we always wanted to be a contribution towards this. The next point is digitalization. What we try to do is, we try to basically bring high tech to the villages. So what we install in the houses are smart meters. We know what's going on there, we know how much they consume, we also know what these households need. And it's in general, digitalization is one of the great chances for us and our future, how we solve many problems, because it just makes things so much more efficient. I mean, there are many problems coming based out of it. So many people might have to look into different kinds of education, might need to change their jobs because many things are not needed in the future anymore, which is of course a threat towards many people. So education is important, but digitalization itself is what I think will have the biggest impact of all these kind of technologies or interventions in the near future. And then we came to something, democratization, which was especially important for me. Because if you know how energy markets work, it's energy means power. If you control who gets access to energy, you have power. If you don't have energy, you don't have that many possibilities. You need energy for everything nowadays. You will not even have access to internet, you will not even have access to proper information if you don't have access to energy. So democratizing the whole process, saying like, not only the big companies, not only the rich people can generate energy and sell it to the other ones. No, everyone should be able to participate there, is something which I think is extremely important, and the technologies nowadays allow for it. And then there comes the last part. So putting all of this together, and what we are trying to do is basically, we said when we started thinking about our technology, these peer-to-peer energy trading platforms, bottom-up grids, however we call it, this is totally disruptive. And we did it on purpose. We said, like, let's do something totally different. But now actually comes also the point where I need to say, like, where we very fast, working here in Bangladesh, reached our limits. Because working in the energy sector means it's a very political sector. There are giant companies, there's the ministries are in there. So we already as a startup from the very beginning, because we were so disruptive, we need to have regular meetings at ministries. It's the energy ministry, we talk to the ICT ministry and so on. And it's not that easy to get the connections. So I think that's especially the first part, I think, where Toro came in. And why it is important to have these kind of institutions who can help startups and help them how to do business here. And the second point was, of course, I mean, you see one of my colleagues, the other co-founders, Hannes, sitting over there. We are all Bideshis here. It's as simple as that. I often say this example of when I grew up in Germany, and of course we work differently there. I tell you two examples now. One, and you can put it wherever you want. Nothing about this is positive, nothing about this is negative, but we wanted to develop a technology here in Bangladesh. And I came here, we came here with our German standards. There's one thing about Germans which I think is good when you develop a technology, but brings you into a lot of trouble in terms of life, is we are never satisfied. Everything needs to be perfect. And that was, of course, the first clash of cultures we experienced here. When you see, for example, when we look, we have often this problem in our company, somebody is working on a project, is working on a product. Every time I come in and I say, ah, this is nice, but can you do it better there? Can you do it better there? And people are always like, am I not doing the work right? I say, like, no, you're great, you're doing amazing work, but let's do it even better. But it's a certain kind of misunderstanding which can come out of it. I can also give you a very simple example. My dad is a carpenter, or was a carpenter. Yesterday I got a wardrobe made from a carpenter. I'm sure, I really like the piece of work the carpenter did. I'm sure if my dad would come and I would show him, would say, like, look at this nice piece of work, he would be like, yeah, but there's something not right yet, and there's something not right. So that's a positive thing I say when you come in terms of product development, but the bad thing about it is we are never satisfied. So that's why I always say, like, there's a positive and negative thing. The second thing I had to learn for sure was rules. In Germany, we have a clear tendency towards there's a rule, you just follow it. Which leads to many problems also if you look into our history. I mean, we were stupid enough to follow a very stupid leader just because we followed rules. So rules are not always good, especially if you want to create a business and want to be a little bit, come up with entrepreneurship. And I think that's where, especially in Bangladesh, people have a nice way to deal with it. In Bangladesh, I often have the feeling it's all about, okay, there's a rule, but how do I get around it? Where's the shortcut? And this is something I had to learn. Things don't work by rules here, or not always by rules. And I say this in a very positive way. This attitude of, you say it should be done this way, but I try to do it a different way, has a lot of advantages. But understanding these kind of cultural differences would not have been possible for us without support from people who know how it works, and maybe also had a little bit like exposure in both directions. The last thing I want to say is, when we started a company here, all of us did it for the first time. And I have made the experience here in Bangladesh, it's such a young population, so many talented people. I myself did not have the privilege, my parents were not entrepreneurs, so I didn't know how it works. So you need someone who tells you how to do it. And I think that's currently still a big lack in the country. And I think that's exactly one of the gaps where Toro is going into. Not just saying, okay, I mean, the one part is, of course, how do I develop a product? But the other thing is, of course, how do I run a company? How do I set it up? So that's, I think, what I wanted to share a little bit about our experience with Toru together, how these guys helped us, and yeah, I think they are doing really amazing work. Keep on doing what you're doing. It's really nice to see what you have created here. And not only we, but I think many, many other young people in the country who want to set up a business are counting on you. So thanks a lot for your support and what you're doing.